I'm just going to be straight up and say that Malcolm and Marie is a straight up 5-star film. 10 out of 10, best movie ever, art out of art, top tier shit. With material like this, I can't believe they're just dropping it on Netflix. Look, if you can see this in cinemas, you should. It is definitively the best way to see it, and I'm glad that I was able to. However, if you can't, it's understandable. I'm sure Netflix will suffice. Either way, get on it. So if for some reason you're watching this and you don't know what the movie's about, I will avoid spoilers. Though that being said, there isn't a whole lot to spoil. This is more of an experience to endure. The film isn't exactly about plot twists, as much as it is about realism, relationships, and the film industry itself. But if you don't know, Malcolm and Marie is a film shot entirely within the confines of COVID-19. Shot on one location, featuring literally only two actors in David Washington and Zendaya, who play the title characters respectively, and there's not an appearance, a picture, phone call, nothing from anybody else at all. The whole film from then on sets us up with a couple coming home together after Malcolm's biggest career achievement of his life, in attending his directorial features film premiere. He comes home with the intention to celebrate and presumably eventually go to bed. Marie, unbeknownst yet to him though, has an issue with the night prior that we never see but only hear interpretations of, and that is that he did not thank her during his speech before the film showed for the very first time. A mistake that he surely should not have made. It was a major dick move. But the thing is, it may have just been an accident. And that's the beauty of Malcolm and Marie. We never truly get to see the objective truths in their arguments, but only ever get to hear their sides. It's a he said, she said, made up of 100 minutes of passionate monologues, and it's just so my jam. I couldn't have been more into this. From there, the film goes on to depict this romantic couple as they escalate things from there and have what we assume to be is the biggest fight of their relationship to date. The fact that this is such a personal movie about arguing is going to put some people off, either as depressing or boring. And to that, I say cool, you do you, but I was all up for it. I found it fascinating to learn about these characters' histories through dialogue alone, with a limited lens and time frame to work with. The film does amazingly in depicting both sides and cluing us in on what's been going on prior to the events of the film. This is the definition of a slice of life type of movie, and what's more is that the whole thing takes place in real time, or at least almost. We never leave the property, we never skip time to another day, and we're never given the luxury to evade the anger. Believe me, the film gets nasty. They make some harsh arguments as the film goes on, and it gets ugly between these two characters, going further and further into their deep roots of their problems personally and romantically. Malcolm and Marie becomes engaging this way, giving us a peek into this realistic life and fight. And what's more is that the whole movie isn't a fight. Just like in real life, there are breaks in the tension. They stop, they be real for a moment. If something changes, like news springs up on them, they'll fall back into who they really are and talk honestly and calmly. Or if they've just gotten over one particularly gnarly moment of their argument, they may forgive and forget and have a laugh for a good few minutes, getting closer and just enjoying each other's company, right before they spring back into another argument as they're reminded of something else by some innocuous detail brought up, or because they've been left alone with their thoughts for too long and they realize that the tension that they forgot about is still there. It's so fantastic because it's realistic. This on and off again style of fighting is what people do. This is real, and it's not something that's often depicted in fiction. Clearly these people love each other dearly, but clearly there are elements of imperfections there, as there is with everyone. So yes, while the film might be about wealthy people arguing in their gigantic house, this never feels elitist. This is grounded as hell, particularly if we forget about details like those. I relate to both Malcolm and Marie in different ways, and I relate to the argument in a relationship in different ways. Not that all the details are the same, not in the slightest really, but the emotions at times is. Malcolm and Marie both are characters that we come to care about, and the great thing about the film is that it doesn't pick a side for the most part. A majority of the time, the camera unobjectively, unbiasedly shows us what each character says. They both get their moments to shine, to wreck, to wallow. And honestly, the details on whether we as an audience agree or not sometimes isn't even the point, and can't be the point, as we simply don't know for sure one way or the other when it comes to particular things. Like an argument involving their exes that has nothing to do with us. Like, we never see that. This is all set on one night. We don't know the truth when it comes to that kind of stuff from their past. So we as watchers work with what we've got and agree and disagree as the film goes on. It's something magical that I don't think is done very often, or very well very often at least. And that being said, I think that if everything just went a little to the left, this could have easily ended up being a very boring movie. But it just just was not a boring movie. I love it so much. I love, though, that after these moments of unbiased depiction, that the film then goes on to show us scenes like Malcolm ranting like a madman about dumb shit, haphazardly complaining about minute details and their meanings. He comes and goes out of rooms and energetically gets into it. His bravado attitude, like as if he is always right, and the arrogance that shines through, along with legitimately good points that he makes, comes off as comedic and downright hilarious, as it also shows Marie barely reacting to these moments as if she's seen it all before. She's not impressed by this performance, she's not moved or taken aback. In these moments, the camera turns Malcolm into an idiot, and it's just so, it's done so well. And throughout the film, tones shift like this seemingly without effort. A small tweak of an angle, a major shift in conversation focus between the two characters, whatever it may be, Malcolm and Marie is able to make these things intensely funny at times to traumatically depressing at other times, all within its simple formula. Also, just by the way, the whole movie is black and white. So for those WandaVision haters, fuck me, I guess you'll probably think this one is boring as well. Speaking of boring though, something that I was thinking about after watching the movie was this. So the other night, maybe a few weeks ago, whenever it was, I tried to watch Godzilla, King of Monsters on Netflix. Now, there were a few problems that I had with my experience watching the movie beyond just the movie's fault. Like, I have the cheapo version of Netflix, so the picture quality is borderline unwatchable. It's abysmal. So for a film like this, you know, my main gripe might be that I couldn't really even see the fucking monsters properly. But that, despite that, really what I didn't like about Godzilla 2 is that it's boring as fuck. And look, I'm not trying to sound like a smartass here. I realize how that might come off, but hear me out. Godzilla 2 was all about people in boardrooms talking about strategies for dealing with these giant monsters and not a whole lot else. Occasionally, we'd go off to see monsters meaninglessly battle, and sure, that's fun, but I don't know. It's not like I've never seen that before. I've become numb to that kind of thing cinematically, to be honest. It's all CGI monoliths like these that are beautiful and cool, but they don't really leave a lasting impression. But honestly, beyond the monsters fighting, a large bulk of Godzilla 2 is just a whole bunch of dudes in suits or whatever standing around, and they're just talking, and like, there's no personality that comes through. It doesn't matter who's saying what, all of their dialogue could be interchanged, and there's just no character there. It wouldn't make a difference who says what and what happens. There's no personal stakes apart from being killed by giant monsters or whatever, and I find that painfully boring. So where I'm going with this is that I didn't find one single moment of Malcolm and Marie boring in comparison. It was mesmerizing through and through. The craziest thing about this, though, is that this came up under heavy restriction. Most filmmakers want to make things that are way more grandiose than this, that play into heavier, more complex stories, that has more to play with in terms of characters and timelines. But goddamn, if this movie proves anything, it's that you absolutely don't need a multi-million dollar budget to make riveting cinema. And I want to see more like it, badly. I wish more filmmakers would challenge themselves in this way. Best not to be out of necessity because of a worldwide pandemic next time, and instead done so electively, but still, if more filmmakers went more about trying their darndest to tell such an impactful story by doing so little, I think we'd be all the better for it. That being said, I also think that we'd get tons more boring shit, because I don't think that just anybody can handle a script like this, and I don't think just anybody can perform with such ferocity like this, and I definitely don't think that the audience side, that everyone is gonna be here with me. I think tons of people are gonna find this boring as shit, and tons of people are gonna be on their phones while watching, because this is a Netflix release, and heaps will never see through till the end, and it kind of annoys me. But now I sound pretentious. This is the opposite of what I want. Look, I'm not a fan of The Godfather, for instance, okay? So I'm not pretentious, is what I'm saying. I think The Godfather's boring. I won't pretend that I like it just because everyone says it's like the greatest film ever. I don't like a lot of older films because of their pacing and how long they take to get to the point. I'm not the biggest fan of directors like Scorsese or Nolan. Funnily enough, actually, because of our lead actor here, I found Tenet to be ridiculously boring, too complex for its own good, and just plain unenjoyable. In fact, Malcolm and Marie is the very antithesis of Tenet. Everything about it is the complete opposite. There are no sweeping shots of cars blowing up in reverse time, but only shots of a house and two people. There aren't any government agent spies or terrorists or whatever trying to save the world or threaten to blow it up. Instead, there is just one argument taking place between two people. The stakes aren't quite so unrealistically high. Tenet is about Not even people. Tenet is about chess pieces. Tenet is about gimmicks like weird time travel concepts, but mostly it's just all about complicated espionage and super spy missions, and it's just a film that takes itself way too seriously and tries too hard to confuse its audience with the intention of looking clever. It's a noisy and loud and in-your-face mess, but it's also bloated at 2.5 hours and it doesn't do that much with its runtime. Tenet is, I dare say, bad, but Malcolm and Marie though has heart. It's not a film that tries too hard to show off in terms of action sequences or storylines. It's instead something so much more simple yet so much more deep. It's something that moved me, that had me on the edge of my seat at times for the people involved and my hopes for them, and it made me uncomfortable too, and I think that's a testament to how effective it was. Tenet for me never reached the highs of Malcolm and Marie. For all its action and craziness, I never felt compelled. It was never as powerful. And maybe this again makes me sound like I'm some sort of snobby asshole, but that's not the point I'm trying to make. I'm not Mr. Snobby Film Man, okay? That's not me. I like the MCU a lot. Fuck, I like bad movies too. I like the Wrong Turn series. I like the Elm Street sequels to no end. I like the Star Wars sequels the most out of the franchise, apart from Rise of Skywalker. I didn't like Midsommar or The Lighthouse. I thought they were just convoluted messes. I did love Hereditary though, which has similar respect in terms of its reputation. I absolutely hated The Wolf of Wall Street. I think it's sexist, but I'm a big fan of Parasite. I fucking love it. And I saw that in July in 2019. I saw that before the hype, so yeah. What I'm trying to say is that I don't particularly care about the majority opinion. I don't buy into the fanfare of blockbusters, and I don't automatically like something deemed to be prestigious. And I will like presumably shitty horror movies or whatever may be deemed to be mediocre. I will like what I like. It's just, I like what I like and I don't like what I don't. I'm just genuine. I don't care about reputation. It's not about that for me. And Malcolm and Marie, I didn't only like, but I fucking loved. And I don't quite know what the reputation of that's going to be yet. It's too early to tell for sure, but I do think that a lot of people are going to think that it's boring, it's cheesy, it's over the top, it's trying too hard to be Oscar bait. I think that that's definitely criticism that this movie is going to get. But I don't know. Maybe it is, but I loved it nonetheless. So yeah, while things do get messy in their argument in the film, and while it does take this interesting look at this depiction of an argument with absolute grace, I think what's best about Malcolm and Marie is its ability to grab your attention with what so little it has to begin with. This film is something to appreciate. You know, you can appreciate its acting, you can appreciate its limitations as well. It's written so cleverly with this almost rhythmic dialogue, and it all comes out so perfectly. It's beautiful, it's fun, it's just so great as it depicts this snapshot into the lives of these fictional characters who I'm also going to assume aren't that fictional, because this rings too true. And with that, I think Malcolm and Marie deserves to have the world's attention, but I'm not so sure it will. I think it will get praise from certain critics and film buffs. Maybe it will be in the Oscars, I don't know. But I don't necessarily think that this is going to be a crowd pleaser, not in the slightest. But I say that as if Malcolm and Marie was ever a film that wanted to be a crowd pleaser.